his spirit, his essence, his being embodied in me for 2 weeks. It was just this sudden thing that happened where I didn't tell anybody, but I could feel it the whole time. His words were nonstop going through my mind, just speaking the whole time. And there was a radiance coming out of me that I don't think anybody could see, but I could feel it and know it. And I would look in the mirror to see it, and I would see the radiance of him coming through my eyes and all around me when I would look. And it was just a nonstop embodiment of Jesus for those 2 weeks. And I mean,
I'd like to welcome to the show Stephanie Kraft. How are you doing, Stephanie?
Oh, I'm doing well, Alex. How are you?
I'm doing very good. Thank you so much for coming on the show. Today's conversation with you, you have a lot of stuff going on. A lot of things have happened to you in your life. It's not just one thing or another, but it's all really connected, which is what I find fascinating about your life story. So before we get into conversations about your day job now, which is a life between lives hypnotherapist, that you've had a lot of stories and experiences in that, and a healer. What I find fascinating is that your story starts off as someone who was atheist, someone who had completely rejected God and Jesus. Can you talk to me a little bit about what caused you? You know, were you raised spiritually and then you rejected it? Were you just like, this is ridiculous? What brought you to that place?
Okay, well, my parents were Catholic. They did baptize us three kids. Mm-hmm. But they didn't really raise us with any religion at all. They did attempt to bring us to church, to mass, you know, Catholic mass. But when you're a kid, that's Latin, you know, it's a different language.
It's horrible. It's horrible.
Yeah. So I remember being in church thinking like, or in general, like, having this, I think I was born with this where I thought it was mythology. I didn't think it was. And then when I found out people actually believed it, I was like, people actually believe that? I thought it was just a story, you know, and nothing ever resonated with me, but not that I even knew anything. It's like, there was no teaching. My family had, God was never mentioned. So even though they attempted to bring us to church when we were very little, I think that they thought we're doing the right thing, but it wasn't even embodied in them. And then they dropped it because my older sister refused to wear a dress. And my mother wanted her to wear dresses when we went to church. And it was always this huge fight. And so they were like, they gave up and we just never went. And I was maybe four or five. And that was the end of it. So I had a general feeling of like God, right? Like God exists, but I had zero religion and I didn't believe in religion per se. So when I was 10, a friend of mine was murdered, and unfortunately, her mother killed her.
Oh, and wow.
Yeah. So I had just been slept over at her house, and like, so when this happened, it literally shattered my entire world, because when you're 10, you don't have this idea that a mother could kill her child. Like, that's not in the realm of possible. Right. So I remember walking home from school. I remember the exact moment where I was, because when this trauma happened in my life, everything that I thought was true was no longer true. And so I remember walking home from school, and in my mind, I said to myself, I'm not believing in God anymore, because if that can happen, then there's definitely no God. That's a 10-year-old mind. And that was it. So from age 10, I would say agnostic or atheist until age 29, when I had a massive spiritual awakening. So do you want me to talk about that?
Yeah. So how do you, all right, so you, so 19 years, good amount of time.
Yes.
That this is all hogwash. This is ridiculous. That, by the way, my so sorry that you had to go through that at 10 years old, because I can only imagine, because you're right, at a 10-year-old experience, that doesn't even cross your mind. It's not even, you know, bad things happen in the world. I mean, at that, I mean, especially, you know, depending on the generation you were raised in, you have TV, you hear things. I mean, we know the bad things happen in the world, but the concept of a mother killing a child at that such a, even at such a young age, it just didn't even, it doesn't comprehend. So it must have been completely earth shattering to you. And that would throw you into, you know, crisis of faith, if you will, without question.
It did. I mean, I even asked my own mother if she would kill me, because now everything's on the table.
Right. It's like, so mom, can we have a conversation? Yeah. And imagining that that also probably, that probably shifted the way you reacted to the world now. Your programming, the set of rules that are in your programming at this stage changes interactions with the entire reality that you have, correct?
100%. And I had PTSD. It's something that I didn't talk about, because at 10, you don't have the language for it and you don't get the help you need. It's just a fact. Like, sure. When things like this happen. So I was having, I was having intrusive thoughts of her, my friend's mom, killing me. And I was also having a experience at night when I would go to sleep every night, where these aliens were coming into my third eye vision. When I would close my eyes to go to sleep, they would visit me every night, and it would, I felt in terror. But now I'm thinking it might have been a spiritual family reaching out to comfort me, but I didn't know that. And I willed them to go away eventually, and they finally did. But I was having terror every single day, in specific instances, one of them going to sleep, and then another one when I would imagine her coming to kill me. So, you know, and yes, it did shatter my entire reality, my entire world, my worldview, absolutely everything. I retreated into my mind, because it was so shocking and traumatic that I couldn't process it. I couldn't understand why. And my big question was why? And so all I was doing was thinking. And that cut off my actual, you know, processing of the trauma or feeling, and which opened up later on in my life. And so, but the question has always been why, but that let, you know, flowed over into, you know, my adulthood of where do we go when we die? You know, what happens when we die? Things like that.
And then I imagine that just as a young adult, relationships must have been difficult, and you might have been guarded against having relationships or even friendships, or because again, everything is on the table. Like at any time, something could happen. It's that kind of trauma is, and imagine no one was around helping you process this trauma or identifying this trauma. So this was all you dealing with it 110%.
100% on my own.
Right. So this, again, just moving forward. So I find it fascinating, because a lot of people go through trauma, especially young trauma, especially with our parents. And I will talk about your parents later on, because I've heard the choices you've made in life between lives to choose this situation. But the traumas that we all go through, it does really skew our perspective on humanity, on our reality, what we think is possible, what the potential of dangers is. It's pretty fascinating. And going through from such a young age, 10 to 29, it's almost two decades of this kind of thought pattern. So what was it? Because I have to imagine something pretty large had to come in, other than it wasn't a near-death experience, I don't think. So
yeah.
It's something had to come in and just, because and tell me if I'm wrong, from my personal experience, the universe was probably tapping you on the shoulder, probably for a while. Spiritual taps, like, hey, no, I know you had some rough times, but no, this is real. No, no, here, I'm like, no, there, here's an example of faith, or here's an example of the other side, or here's, and you were like having none of it till finally the universe is tap, 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 whisper, 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 sledgehammer across the head. And I think what you're about to talk about is the sledgehammer across the head.
Yes. So those taps really did not start until the year 2000 when I was 29, because I think my soul just let me, okay, go ahead, live
process it,
like asleep. And then boom, in the year 2000 was when it happened. And so the first thing that happened was my friend said, you should get a psychic reading. And I was like, why would you even waste your money on something like that? It's fake. What, you know, I thought you were an intelligent woman. What are you doing? And she said, no, Stephanie, let me lend you my tape. And back then it was the cassette tapes. Mm-hmm. So the guy records it. So I went home, I listened to it, and he literally read everything about her, things he could not have possibly known. So I said, okay, I'll make an appointment. So I made the appointment with him, and I was skeptical. I didn't believe in anything. And I told him, you know, I said, I'm just not going to really say much because I'm kind of testing you because I don't believe in this really. But he was very cool and, you know, about it all. And he read my heart and soul in such a way that nobody could ever know. And he said to me, Stephanie, you're a healer and a teacher. And it resonated in my soul and in my heart, because I had been delving deeply into, you know, maybe I should become an acupuncturist. I want to help people at a very deep level. I knew that already. And when he said healer, I was like, ding, 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 you know, this is true. And so that, because that reading was reading my heart and soul, it actually bursted me wide open. It was my catalyst for my spiritual awakening. I mean, I was blown away. I was like, if he can know things, then there's so much more. And that night when I was trying to sleep, I didn't sleep the entire night. I had my eyes closed and all I could see was the universe. I was seeing in my third eye the entire universe, because it had busted wide open, and I was there now. I was seeing it. Mm-hmm. And so that was a memorable experience. It was my first, the catalyst of my spiritual awakening. And then it was the tap, tap, tap. Things were happening, but boom, 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 boom. That year, in rapid succession, I was having major health problems. I don't want to get into that because it's not really integral to the story, but I was sick. And then, you know, so I don't know. Then my father was actually diagnosed with terminal cancer, but something else happened prior to that, which was a meeting with his soul. I don't know if you want me to talk.
Yeah.
About
how did you meet your father's soul?
So nobody knew he had cancer. He didn't know. We were just, nothing was happening, you know, in that way. But a couple months before his diagnosis, I had, during my sleep time, and I don't call it a dream because it was a spiritual experience. His soul was before me, and my father was a psychologist, and he was very into his work, which I don't blame him. It's fascinating. And he was all about helping his patients, and he, you know, very intellectually focused, but he kind of forgot about his family. So he didn't really pay much attention to us. He was emotionally disconnected and distant. So he was there as the father and my mom's husband, but not really interacting much, just, you know, working all the time. So in this experience, his soul was standing before me, and I had this rage that I didn't know I had, and it came out of me. And you know how in those experiences, it's really telepathic, but the rage poured out of me. Almost, I compare it to like a fire breathing dragon, because it's just pouring out, and it was a rage that's not humanly possible. And I said to him in this, I said, "Dad, you were never there for me. You never touched me, never gave me affection, never said I love you. You did nothing for me as a father, nothing." And he stood there with such innocence on his face and shock, because he did, and I could read him fully. He didn't know that his behavior actually had an effect on others. That was new to him. He had no clue. He was just living his life. And, you know, and maybe because he thought he was giving so much in service, that was his role. Great. Kudos to you. But you have 3 kids and a wife. But anyway, so he had so much innocence, so much like, "I'm sorry." And the innocence was so pure. The benevolence was so strong, and the not wanting to do harm. And when I saw all of that in him, it was an immediate forgiveness, like a forgiveness of that there's nothing to forgive. There is nothing to forgive. And what we have between us is pure, unconditional love. And it was in an instant. It all washed away. We had unconditional love between us, and that was it. And I woke up with that. And 2 months later, he was diagnosed with terminal cancer, and I dropped everything. I was living in Denver, Colorado. I'm from Washington, D.C. I dropped everything as fast as I could, and I moved home to take care of him. And so I'm having these profound spiritual experiences. I'm having my awakening, and then I go home to take care of him. He's in the death process having his spiritual awakening. So we got to travel along in that way for 5 months. He died 5 months later, but we had that time together, and the words weren't spoken. I never said anything to him about my experience with our souls, but the healing that had happened between our souls manifested in life between us, where it was pure, unconditional love and beautiful bonding, and no words needed to be spoken. But the love was just there, and it was, what a gift.
That's beautiful. That's really beautiful. I'd like to hear your perspective on the soul family. Because we talk about soul family on the show a bunch, but yeah, I want to hear your perspective on it and why we choose the parents that we are brought into this life with. Because most people listening going, "I didn't choose my parents," but you did. better or worse. So, and you didn't have, you had a, from my understanding, you had a little bit, it wasn't a lovely, you know, wonderful, as you just stated with your father, lovely, supportive, wonderful upbringing as a child. There were some ups and downs. So can you explain to him what a soul family is and why you chose your family and the purpose of that?
Right. So soul family would be soul mates in a soul group. So, and as souls, we like to travel together with these members of our soul family to learn, to teach each other. We decide before we incarnate what role we'll play for each other and what we hope to learn from that. And so we get to incarnate with these members of our soul group. And if we have a, you know, soul group of, I don't know, 100 souls, we might incarnate with 4, you know, in a lifetime, or 6 or 10 or 1, you know, but other souls that we know might also be in like nearby soul groups. So we know them too, but that's my understanding. And not everybody in your family is necessarily in your soul group. For example, my father is, because I had a Life Between Lives hypnotherapy session once, and I asked who's in my soul family, and I saw my father. But I don't necessarily think my mother is, although I think we do incarnate together with these souls for learning, and we do choose our parents because we want to experience things that will challenge us and stretch us and help us to better some of the themes that we're working on, whether it's forgiveness or unconditional love or compassion or standing up for ourselves or setting boundaries, you know, the list goes on.
So can you explain to somebody who's listening, who's had an abusive family, who had abusive parents, who made their life a living hell, how could I have ever chosen that to exist right in this life?
So I think that right now a lot of souls are stopping the toxic, abusive cycles in families. So I think that if somebody is born and they're completely different from their parents, they're not abusive, they're not toxic, they're not as dysfunctional, but they do go through that trauma with their parents, and then they decide to raise their children differently or have a different kind of relationship with their spouse or people in general, that they are stopping that karma, that that ancestral line of toxicity. So I think that's one role that a lot of people play. I did have an experience with my mother's higher self that showed me why I chose her. She is a narcissist, and I actually went no contact with her 14 years ago. But one day I was driving in my car, and this was the only time I ever had an encounter with her higher self. Her higher self just quickly swooped in, like by the driver's window. I'm driving, and she visited me. And when I felt her come to me, I felt love from her for the first time in my life. And that told me, wow, I've never felt love from my mother at all, not for one second, until that moment, because that was the moment I felt it for the first time. So, but it was from her soul. And she said to me only one thing. She said, I wanted you to be in your power. So I got it, that she was my bully, you know, and she and I had to stand up for myself and become strong and create boundaries and speak up for myself for whatever reason. Maybe I hadn't done that in a past life. I have no idea. But I had been told by a healer once, because I was in the Holocaust in another lifetime. And mm-hmm. I was told your mother was the one who, I was killed in the gas chamber, but she's the one mm-hmm. who kind of like operated it and killed me.
Oh, wow.
So who knows? I don't have a direct memory of, I have memories of that lifetime, but not of her being there, but I believe it. That's a whole other story.
That's another story. Can I ask you, growing up with, as you just stated, a mother who never showed you really affection, and a father who was detached from you, how you process, and then you had the 10 year old trauma, how did you process a childhood without this, you know, because I was raised in a fairly loving relationship, a very, very loving family. Yeah, we had issues. Yeah, there's ups and downs, and there are holes, all sorts of drama that we all, you know, all families do. But generally speaking, I can never say that I wasn't loved. I was loved. So I'm curious how, because I'm sure other people listening have gone through this. How did you process? How did you function through life without this?
I really did retreat into my mind a lot, trying to figure things out and being overly analytical. And I think that's a trauma response. And I think a lot of people can relate to that. It was really about raising myself. And so I'm glad I have that highly analytical mind, because I use it in my work. I can understand people very well. But it was really about an inner strength, an inner will to like keep going. I think it has to do with your soul, you know, getting really in alignment with your soul and just getting through it and being strong and choosing to be loving, you know, taking that example and saying, I'm going to be the most loving, forgiving, wonderful person. I mean, I was already born that way. We're born really pretty much with our personality and soul, you know, soul essence. And that was who I've always been. And that helped me get through it. And you don't know when you're a child that it is dysfunctional. I thought I had the greatest family and that we were perfect. It wasn't until a little bit later that I realized, oh my God, that was highly abusive. Actually, I was abused, you know? So, but yeah, it's an inner strength, I think, that gets people through it. and then a determination to do well, to be your best self, really.
So my research on you, you also had an experience or a couple of experiences with Yeshua or Jesus, as he's known. I'd love to hear, and I always joke, Jesus is the hardest working man in show business, because he's always on near-death experiences. He's always hanging. He does a lot of stuff. Shiva, never hear that much. Buddha, barely hear about that. They do come in, by the way. I do hear them from other people's stories, but generally speaking, I guess because we're in the West, basically raised as a Christian country, Jesus is working heavy over here. So what was your first experience, your spiritual experience with Jesus?
This is something I hesitate to say, mm-hmm. but since I'm opening my mouth now, I'll just share. I had a dream in which it's the only dream that I know I have had with my spirit guide. And my spirit guide came to me and said, "You are Jesus." Mm-hmm. And I said, "No, no, 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 no." And he said, "No, you are Jesus." And mm-hmm. I went like this, and I was like, okay, there can be no ego in knowing about this. But then when I woke up, I was like, okay, let me try to analyze this. I'm a healer. I'm a way shower. I'm all about love and forgiveness. Okay. I get it. I'm walking the path. I've been abused in the past. I resurrected. So that was a first. But then shortly after that, I had this experience where, I didn't believe in him, by the way.
is this pre-29?
So with my spiritual awakening, it was a spiritual awakening, but not yet on board with Jesus. I was like,
he's still attached to religion. So there it is. Yeah.
I was like, I still don't believe in that.
I believe in everything else, but not this dude.
Angels are real. I don't know about Jesus.
That's the religious programming you still had in your head from being a Catholic. Trust me, I'm a recovering Catholic myself.
Well, I didn't have any religious programming in this lifetime. Zero. When I say my parents tried to take us to church, I don't remember a word of it. And there was no religion in my upbringing.
So you wasn't programming. But you knew that Jesus was you didn't even remember that Jesus was part of the Catholic Church?
I thought it was a myth.
Got it. So he was still, but he was attached.
All religion is mythology. It's not real.
Got it. Fair enough. Okay. So when Jesus shows up, how does it happen?
So Jesus, I guess he really wanted me to believe in him because his spirit, his essence, his being embodied in me for 2 weeks. It was just this sudden thing that happened where I didn't tell anybody, but I could feel it the whole time. His words were nonstop going through my mind, just speaking the whole time. And there was a radiance coming out of me that I don't think anybody could see, but I could feel it and know it. And I would look in the mirror to see it, and I would see the radiance of him coming through my eyes and all around me when I would look. And it was just a nonstop embodiment of Jesus for those 2 weeks. And I mean, that was profound. That was one, of the experiences.
Well, let me ask you this. Being such an analytical person, being, concrete mind person, when this started to happen to you, at what point did you decide to go public with this, come out of the spiritual closet? Because I had imagined with your friends, colleagues, even family members, whoever. I mean, what we're talking about, we'll clear a room.
It's not, I don't talk about it every day. Now I only,
you don't lead with it
privately, but being on here, it's a little,
exactly. Public.
But when it happened in approximately 2007 or six, I'm not sure the year, six, seven, eight. Mm-hmm. And then I was on this spiritual forum, private group that you had to pay membership. So I was, and there was a large group of people in this spiritual community. And I one day decided, you know what? I'm just going to write about my experience. I've never told anybody. This is a safe place. I typed it out and I just, the little bit I told you, that's all I had to say about it. And two other women wrote, replied and said the same thing happened to them. And it was also for 2 weeks. And I was, wow, I was amazed that that had happened. And then it wasn't until years later, I have a YouTube channel and I decided something nudged me. The only way I make videos is when my higher self pushes me to talk about something. I don't do it unless that happens. And that was what was happening. Talk about your Jesus experiences. So I was like, okay, other people have done it. I've seen them do it. That means it's okay. And if I do it, then other people will say, oh, she did it. It's okay. So that more people, because look, I'm not the only one. A lot of people have Jesus experiences and they're probably afraid to talk about it. So I went ahead and made videos called My Jesus Experiences. And that was, I don't know, maybe around, I don't know, 2017, 18, 19, around that time. I don't know when.
So how did people around you deal with this, this information when it came out?
Well, I'm lucky because my entire realm of friends are like me. So it was like, oh, that's cool. Let me tell you about mine.
Gotcha. So at this stage in life, you're surrounded with yourself with like-minded people. So it wasn't as awkward as it would have been in your early life if that would have come out. Okay. So I wanted to talk to you also about your pre-birth communication with your son. Now, we've talked about pre-birth communications, pre-birth experiences on the show a lot. Do you remember, by the way, do you have any pre-birth experiences of remembering choosing the soul blueprint, the life blueprint, your parents, any of that stuff? And then also then going into this pre-birth communication with your son.
So I don't personally have any memories, pre-birth memories myself. The pre-birth communication with my son happened one of them was not directly through me, but through an energy healer. So I was, when I was pregnant, I was over at someone's house and she had a baby name book. And I looked through the book to say, like, what should I name my son when he is born? I don't know. So I opened the book and there's Adonis. And Adonis, as we know, is Greek god, means handsome. And I chuckled. I was alone actually in this moment looking at the book. And I chuckled inwardly, like that would be so ridiculous if I named my son Adonis. And the next day I had a session with this energy healer over the phone and she was able to communicate with my son, his soul. So this was like a thing that had been happening and I didn't say anything to her. I was just listening to whatever she was saying. And she said, your son, your baby is laughing. And he's saying, you should name me Adonis. So I realized in that moment that the soul of my baby was able to read my thoughts, knew what I was thinking.
Wow.
That was pretty mind blowing.
That's amazing. And did you name your son Adonis?
He is very handsome though.
That is funny. So you also had a walk-in experience as well. Now what you said sounded like the Jesus experience was a walk-in experience in a way as well. Can you explain to people what a walk-in is and then explain your experience if you don't mind?
Okay, so there are a couple different kinds of walk-ins. One of the very common kinds that maybe a lot of people might know about if they know about a walk-in is that there's a soul, the person is maybe wants to commit suicide, they're going through major trauma, they want to exit this lifetime, but on the soul plane, there's an agreement made with another soul to trade. So it's like, okay, I'm going to leave and your soul is going to come in, a different soul, and inhabit this body to continue this life. So that's a soul, like a switch of the soul, an exchange. That did not happen to me. But and I didn't have any, there was no trauma happening at the time. For me, mine was the other kind where an aspect of your higher self comes in to be embodied that hasn't been here before. And it feels like a walk-in. It is a walk-in, because when that happened to me, I didn't know that that's what had happened yet, but I was literally looking through new eyes, and I was looking around at humans. And in my mind, I was calling them humans. And I knew I wasn't one, because I was brand new here. That aspect of my soul was just here and new for the first time, looking at the humans and just saying, look at all these humans. And I was observing them as different, you know, foreigners to me. And everything changed then. I would say my vibration changed to such a degree that I changed, but it wasn't that noticeable. It wasn't like I was acting differently, but that was an internal shift. And I started reading spiritual books as if they were food, you know, just devouring book after book after book. So this was another layer of a massive spiritual awakening. My spiritual awakening started in 2000, and it was continuing rapidly, ongoing all these years with massive experiences that just kept happening. So that was how that walk-in went.
But it wasn't a permanent, obviously, walk-in, because I've heard of permanent walk-ins.
It was permanent.
So this is the soul that you're talking to now with me right now is the soul that jumped in?
So it's my being, my soul that was already here stayed, mm-hmm. and this new aspect came in and integrated.
Okay, so it's an integration, but I've heard of stories where like one soul just leaves.
Correct.
And another one just picks up the body. He's like, okay, I'll take this one. If no one's using it, I'll take this one and we'll go from here.
And that's the first example I gave of what people generally think of as a walk-in. And that, I think, is a more massive change, even though mine was pretty big.
Pretty big as well. With all your experience as a hypnotherapist, I'd love to hear your thoughts on near-death experiences and why they happen and the purpose of why they're happening, and just your take on them in general from all your spiritual experiences and also your experiences life between lives and all that kind of stuff.
Well, it's such an interesting question because I do the life between lives hypnotherapy, and then I have been studying NDEs for probably 20 years or more. So there's an overlap, meaning that both are discovering what it's like on the other side and then coming back to tell. And I think that people are having NDEs nowadays, and they're so public now, people like your show and others are allowing people platforms to talk about their NDEs. And I think it's so big right now because it's a deeper teaching for humanity. About ourselves, and that it must be that the times that we're in is allowing for the consciousness to accept it and integrate it, and then it's broadening our consciousness and helping us evolve spiritually as people, as souls, as humanity. So I think that it's so prevalent. Before that, I think that these people have volunteered to have these traumatic and profound experiences and come back and share in service. And that, I'm sure they know that, because if they're, you know, willing to talk about it and openly, it is service to humanity. So I really do think it's about our evolution as humans.
Well, I mean, it is a pretty traumatic event, dying as a general statement. Why do you think that certain souls need that kind of wake-up call or needs that experience to continue their evolution in this life? Because it's pretty much the most extreme way to wake you up, in my opinion. There is not, I don't foresee any other thing that's more intense than a near-death experience. So I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
I do. I agree with you. And I think it is for these people to come back as teachers and way showers because humanity needs it. Humanity's consciousness is very low, and it's time to raise it up. And through these teachings, people coming back and sharing, I really think it's part of the raising of the consciousness of humanity. And I think that they have been willing to go through that for the collective. So on a personal level, everybody's going to have their own individual reasons. It's going to be a catalyst for their life, for people around them. And then on a collective level, when they share, it can cause, I think their stories can cause spiritual awakenings for others.
Let me ask you this. Do you think, because we've had spiritual teachings and spiritual masters who walk the earth for thousands of years, Jesus being one of them, Buddha, Shiva, you know, we could go on and on of so many different spiritual masters. It seems now, though, these little stories of near-death experiences, of your spiritual awakenings, of these stories are acting as a many, many arms of a spiritual master. So in other words, if Jesus showed back up today, I don't know how, it's going to be a difficult sell in today's world. It's just going to be a difficult sell. But if those teachings can be diluted, or it's not diluted, but spread out throughout hundreds of thousands of people all talking about the same kind of teachings from their perspectives of near-death experience or spiritual awakening, things like that, that's also raising the consciousness. Because when Jesus showed up, he raised the consciousness of humanity. When Buddha showed up, he raised it. When Confucius showed up, he raised it. And so many other spiritual masters who've walked the earth. And there are spiritual masters right now walking the earth who are raising consciousness as well. But it has to be done differently than it was 2,000 years ago. Would you agree?
Oh, I agree completely. And I think that you're touching on this, that these people who have NDEs, who come back and share, that is, you know, it's like literally the teachings of Jesus coming through multitudes of people to spread the word, you know, mm-hmm. what he tried to do, which, you know, has gotten a bit muddled. I mean,
you're being very kind.
I'm a big fan of Jesus's teachings. And unfortunately, you know, it gets lost in religion, but those of us who are not religious can really embrace his teachings, his words. And now with the NDE, you know, people, they are now spreading the same messages on a wide scale. And it's coming from everyday people where it's easy to take it in and really absorb it. And nobody is trying to, well, Jesus didn't try this either, but nobody's trying to stand on a pedestal and be a way shower or a teacher. They're just sharing personal experience, you know, and they're not preaching anything to anybody.
And that's the way it has to kind of come out in today's world. Because if you, like I said, if a Jesus character showed up on the world stage, it just wouldn't work in the way it did 2,000 years ago. It just wouldn't work. But I think you're absolutely right. These experiences, and by the way, there's out-of-body experiencers, there's channelers, there's near-death experiencers, there's psychic mediums. There's so many different messengers of this message out there that it's the only way that I can kind of get out today. And then there's shows like mine and others who are putting it out into a world, you know, because near-death experiencers, unless they have a marketing background or have a platform, generally don't. Or they just write a book and hopefully some people will read it. But with YouTube, with podcasting, with these kinds of shows, it is spreading to millions and millions, tens of millions of people, hundreds of millions of people a month, if not billions of people a month. And that's very, very powerful.
It's powerful and it's exciting.
Because mm-hmm. Do you agree that it is, our consciousness is raising? I mean, yes, it's been low, the lowest, I think, was the Dark Ages. I think that was where we peaked. That was the bottom of the barrel, I think. Then we started to come back up. So even in the last 100 years, you know, if we look at the way we treated women 100 years ago or people in general 100 years ago, or slavery 100 years ago, or any of these big concepts, you'd be like, these are barbarians. 100 years from now, we're going to look back and say the same thing about ourselves now. Used to do what to your food? For profit? What did you do to your people? What? You had wars? I hope that's a conversation they're having in 100 years, in not 500 years.
Right.
So, and Jessica, also I'd love to hear your point of view. There is a lot of craziness going on in the world today. We feel it, at least. And this great consciousness is, you know, this rise of human consciousness is also happening because these conversations are happening in a public forum, which they didn't 10 years ago, honestly, 15 years ago, it really didn't happen. So there is something happening. But yet at the same time, we're having ancient wars of ancient arguments that are still going on. And we're having, you know, wars about land again and all these kind of things that we're like, really, is this going on? So how do you coincide those two energies from your point of view?
That's a really tough one because it feels so ancient. Like you're saying that to have war now in this day and age, it seems so foreign and wrong. And it must be that there's almost a splitting of consciousness on the planet because there's some really low vibrational things happening. And then there are people like us having these conversations, which we couldn't even fathom war. It's not part of our consciousness. It doesn't make sense, but yet it's happening on the same planet. So I think that there's a massive group raising consciousness and that people on Earth are having a variety of experiences at the level of where their consciousness is. And in a lot of cases for war, that's going to cause spiritual awakenings for many, you know, millions of people in those experiences, in those situations. Because when for example, in a Life Between Lives hypnotherapy group setting I was in during a demo, we were in a training, and the demo was that the woman went to World War II, to the Holocaust. And when she came back, when she crossed over to the other side and was speaking through as her soul, she was explaining that the purpose was for growing unconditional love. So that if you could have such a horrific experience, then your soul would decide to never do that again and embrace the importance of unconditional love, so that over time, this could shift the consciousness of humanity. So I think that we have, I talked about a splitting. I feel like there's a lot of humanity is massively raising their consciousness. And then there are some parts of humanity that are still stuck in lower consciousness, and they still need their lessons of and learning and experiences, because as we know, each soul chooses the life experience they're having. And this is really a hologram. This isn't like a static planet. It's like you get to choose your reality and what you're born into and what you're going to experience. And the interesting thing about today is that we can actually see, because of the internet and technology, what's happening in other places, but they don't even have anything to do with where we are as a soul. It's such a foreign thing. Mm-hmm. And so there's such a dichotomy of experiences on this planet. And it's always been that way. And I think it'll always be that way. But perhaps because we're all connected in quantum physics, there's this thing called entrainment, that those of us at a higher frequency are carrying the other ones up. You just can't see it, but it's happening gradually.
Right. And every time a conversation like this hits somebody's ears, who's ready for it, it starts to raise everybody's vibration, everyone's frequency a little bit higher, and brings everybody along with them.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It just the way the Dark Ages brought everyone down. Because it was literally, I mean, you went from Renaissance was on the way up, but you went from the Roman Empire and Greek philosophy, and you went down to oh my God, bloodletting and you know, burning people and, you know, all that kind of, you know, insanity to where we are now. So there is a kind of growing, going up, but it is raised. And in the last 200 years, the massive growth of not only technology, but consciousness has been.
I mean, look at the last 20 years, even.
Oh no, and it seems to be accelerating very much so as like a computer chip. So from when I was born, and I'm assuming from you and I are of similar vintage, or close to a similar vintage, what a megabyte was or kilobytes were back in the 80s and 90s and early 2000s to where we are now, it's just it's so fast the way computers are growing and technology is growing. I mean, AI just showed up. Didn't you just hear about the word AI like 6 months ago or a year ago? Like, yeah. It was just like just around the corner, like a year or two ago, you like heard the name for the first time. And now it's really starting to proliferate everywhere. And it's, exactly. It's insane. It's insane.
Yes. And it's not going away.
Oh no, it's definitely not going away. I choose to look at AI as a positive tool and where we're all going to go. And it is a very positive tool. Like any tool, it could be used to build. It could be used to destroy.
Right.
You know, it's same thing. One last question I want to ask you about your experiences with your life between lives and past life therapy. This concept of that there is no past life, there is no future life, that all lives are happening at the same time, which is hard for our little computers to deal with. And if you do something in this life and learn a lesson here, it ripples backwards, quote unquote, and it ripples forward, quote unquote. Can you, I'd love to hear your explanations of that to people.
Yes. I think it's hard to explain, but I do get the concept. It took me a while to mentally grasp it. I think when you hear all lives are simultaneous, at first your mind can't process that, and it takes a while to conceptualize it. Not that we can fully conceptualize it with the human mind because we're living in linear time, but we can attempt to get that. And so because we have time as a construct here in this planet, as part of our physics, it doesn't exist outside of this construct or hologram or whatever this realm is. So you get that, you know, that from the people who have had near-death experiences, how they talk about there's no time on the other side. But so all of our lives are happening simultaneously, which only like the mind of God or our souls could really comprehend. But if the soul aspects come into the bodies in these different time eras, you know, years of Earth history, they're all playing out at the same time. It means that there's also no space. There's no space or time. But here in this playground, it's been created to have that. So it's like, you know, multiple dimensions can co-inhabit space, really. And anything that happens in one life is actually directly affecting the other ones. It's almost like, I think of a way to explain it is like, if you have a rug, you know, like an oriental rug, and has a lot of patterns all over, it's a flat plane. But when you're above it, you could say, okay, I'm going to zoom in onto that flower, or I'm going to zoom in onto that diamond, you know, and it's like any, your soul can go into that, you know, year 1528, or I'm going to go into 2024. So it's like, from the outside, you could just go into this place where all of it exists at once, and our souls get to inhabit, you know, incarnate in all of these different times, but it's all happening at the same time. And it's weird because we talk about how we're learning, right? We're growing, we're evolving, but it's also all already happened. So we're kind of just going along with the, we're just on the ride.
Right. And then if you want to have your head explode, then you're like, well, what about ultimate timelines? And like every choice that you make, every major choice you make in a lifetime, not if you eat, drink ketchup or mustard, that's not a big choice. But if you're like, should I date that person? Should I take this job? Should I move to this city? Well, what would happen if I didn't go to that school? would have never met that person. Well, let's see how that plays out. So that is that true as well?
That's 100% true. There are alternate, you know, parallel timelines, so many that we can't even imagine for your one life. So, you know, you have Alex doing this show, but you also have Alex who really did make it in the movie world and is like a massively successful there. And then you have huge multimillionaire.
Yep, Spielberg. Yep, Spielberg. I'm Spielberg. In another lifetime, I'm Spielberg. There's no question. There's no question. I'm Spielberg.
So, I mean, I've actually seen it with my own eyes. I don't know if you want me to share, but like just visually seeing a, you know, parallel universe.
Of your own life?
Of a friend. She was going to meet me for lunch. And there were two scenarios, one in which her husband drove and kind of hung out, you know, doing window shopping while we went to lunch. And another version where he said at the last minute, no, you just take the car and you go by yourself. And that's what happened. He said, you just go. I knew the other version was going to happen, but at the last minute, he said, you go ahead. I'm just going to stay home. But when I was driving to look for parking, I saw him and her parked on the street, and she got out and went to the restaurant, and then I drove around to park, and then I got there, when I was walking to the restaurant, I saw him sitting in the car looking at his cell phone. So I saw that version, but then I got to the restaurant, and the version of my friend that I saw in the restaurant was the one where he said, no, I'm staying home. You drive yourself, because she told me that. And then at the end of lunch, we both walked to our car, which was not where he was parked, but in the parking garage where I was parked. And she was parked next to me. So I saw the version of her, and I saw her in the other car. I saw the parallel realities of two life streams of her.
So then, is this deja vu?
No, this is literally...
When we have a feeling of deja vu, is it a parallel reality that you're like, God, I've been here before. God, I swear I just saw this happen.
Yeah, it is something like that.
And then let's not get into the Mandela effect, because that has a whole other... That could get into a deep conversation. All right, so I don't know how old you are exactly, but do you know who Ed McMahon was?
Yes, I'm 52, so yeah.
Okay, so yeah, we're both of similar, very, very similar vintage. Okay, so you know who Ed McMahon was. For everybody listening, Google him. Tonight Show, Johnny Carson. Okay. Did he walk up to people's doors with a giant check for Publishers Clearinghouse and give people million-dollar checks?
He absolutely did.
Thank you. I remember that as well. But if you go to Publisher Clearinghouse, it said, Ed McMahon has never worked for us. I'm not kidding you. He's never worked for us. And apparently he worked for another company in a similar fashion, but they never had TV. They never had TV commercials or something. I don't even know what the deal was. Publisher Clearinghouse has no recollection of, and it was Publisher's Clearinghouse. That was what a weird title. What a weird, like, why are they handing out million-dollar checks? It didn't make no sense.
Well, here we go. And it's the Mandela effect literally is this, you know, parallel universe is playing out in different ways.
It is. Yeah. And if anyone wants, I've had quantum physicists on talking about Mandela effect. So please do a search on my show and you'll find out all about the Mandela effect. It's been such a pleasure talking to you. I'm going to ask you a few questions I ask all of my guests. What is your definition of living a fulfilled life?
I think being authentic. Living authentically and in alignment with your own soul.
If you had a chance to go back in time and speak to little Stephanie, what advice would you give her?
I would tell her to express herself more, and it's safe to do that.
How do you define God or source energy?
I think that God or source is everything, the all that is.
What is your definition of love?
Love is who we are and what we are.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
Love.
And where can people find out more about you and the amazing work you're doing in the world?
So my website is stephaniekraft.com. I also have another website because I make products, and it's called Radiant Sun Botanicals. Mm-hmm. And I have a YouTube channel, which is my name, Stephanie Kraft.
And do you have any parting messages for the audience?
Always follow your heart, your soul, your passions, and try to be you, the authentic you.
Stephanie, thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing your experiences with us and for all the work that you're doing to raise the consciousness of the planet. So I appreciate you.
Thank you so much, Alex.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.